Hey, Thomas from Field Tennis. If you've been working on your tennis strokes for a while and you're still struggling with consistency and accuracy and you're unable to hit with effortless power, then it's very likely that you're missing on some of the fundamentals of tennis strokes. And you may be wondering, what do I mean by fundamentals? Because you've been studying online technique like this in slow motion for quite some time. You've been following online tennis coaches. You know a lot about wrist position and elbow position and so on. And I'm claiming that you are likely missing some of the tennis fundamentals. Yes. So I'm starting a series of videos now that will show you what are the fundamentals of groundstrokes. So we're going to talk about forehands and backhands. And today I'm going to show you what is the reason, what are the main reasons why you miss the fundamentals. And I'll give you a simple analogy of how to think about the fundamentals and how they're different from playing styles. So once we have that cleared up, then in the next video I will start talking about each fundamental of tennis stroke in more detail, and hopefully by the end of this series you will be very clear on what you need to work on your own on the tennis court. First, a special thanks to Ian Westerman from EssentialTennis.com for allowing me to use some of his footage for this video. His YouTube channel has many more videos of pros in slow motion, and of course a massive amount of tennis tips and deeper instructional videos. So now you're wondering, what are the forehand and backhand fundamentals? How come they're all the same? I'll explain later each of these and a few others in separate videos, but for now just a quick overview. First, biomechanically, the player is coiling to begin storing energy, and that process then continues with loading one of the legs. The mental process that runs at that time is the rhythm of preparation, where the player reads the ball and prepares in the rhythm that the ball dictates. I want to point out that in this video on the fundamentals, I will not focus on coiling and preparation, because everyone turns to the side in some way or another, and it's not the crucial part missing from their stroke technique. What is usually missing, and what I correct all the time, are the steps that follow. Secondly, you need a solid, stable base off which you will initiate your strokes. Without balance, you will have no consistency. Thirdly, biomechanically, the most important element is body rotation into the shot, especially initiating through the hip rotation. You must do it right though, that means not over-rotating and not just hitting with your arm. Fourth, you need to time your stroke so that you meet the ball in the right contact zone, where your wrist and arm are aligned correctly. If you don't hit the ball in the right distance from the body, the stroke won't work reliably and will not be hit effortlessly. And fifth, on a fundamental level of hitting ground strokes, there is balance also at the end of the stroke. The player is not rushing to recover, but is looking to complete the stroke movement before moving their feet again. Roger Federer is demonstrating all these elements, including the balance at the end of the stroke perfectly, and yet you likely never notice them. If we take a look at the backhand, you will see that the fundamentals are exactly the same, there is just less rotation on the one-handed backhand. We need the right rhythm of our movements with the incoming ball. We need a very stable base off which we will initiate our stroke. We need to initiate the movement through the legs and body rotation, and the hip again leads the rotation, and this is so many times overlooked and yet so fundamental. Then of course we need to time the ball so that we meet it in the ideal contact zone, where the arm and the wrist are aligned properly, and of course we need to maintain balance at the end of the stroke. In my view and experience, these are the most crucial elements of a forehand or a backhand that must be done well, otherwise the stroke will not be reliable, nor it will be executed with effortless power, no matter what the shape of the backswing is, what grip the player uses, or how their follow-through looks like. I'd like to show you another way of looking at the groundstroke fundamentals, and we'll use a neutral stance this time and look at it from a different view. The fundamentals are obviously the same, whether you play a neutral or an open stance, forehand or backhand. Note the two boxes. The first one points out the body area and the second one the initial swing area from backswing to contact, which is what matters most in the swing. The biomechanical fundamentals that this topic is all about happen within the body box. This is the part that needs to be executed correctly, and it's the one most players and coaches pay the least attention to. As you can see, I marked swing style as priority number 4, and you'll see in a minute why. So as we observe Roger begin executing the forehand, we need to pay attention to the sequence of events. And if you're slowly starting to agree with me of the importance of the biomechanical fundamentals, and that they are more important than the swing techniques, then we need to first pay attention to the sequence of events in the body box, as those will also give us the priority of importance and priority of correcting the player. Balance, stability obviously comes first. The foot is firmly planted on the ground and now acts as an anchor, and the leg acts as an axis around which the player rotates their body. The second action in the sequence is the hip rotation, which initiates the body rotation. With most players, the hip rotation is missing as their whole effort goes into the arm swing. The kinetic chain is therefore broken and there's no power transfer to the arm. The final part of the body rotation is the shoulder rotation, which acts as the final lever that we rotate and which enables us to swing the arm effortlessly off one of its ends. This is the sequence of events that happen in the body, and in my view, that also gives us the priority of corrections that we need to apply to the player. The swing corrections, in my view, come only after we have corrected the main biomechanical fundamentals. Now that I've been directing your attention to balance, stability, and body rotation for the last 5 minutes, observe the next few clips of recreational tennis players and think to yourself whether it's more important to start correcting their stability and body engagement into the shot or swing techniques. You'll see the results for yourself, as I mostly work on the fundamentals with adult tennis players. Note how little their swing techniques changed, if at all, and how much better and more consistent their strokes are. On a side note, if you're following an online tennis coach or two, and they just talk and analyze, but never show you any before and after clips of their students, then be very careful, as talking is easy, but teaching is very difficult. As we all know, there are a lot of talkers out there and very few doers. Where are your eyes naturally drawn to? Here's my guess. I think they're drawn to this area marked with yellow lines. Our eyes are naturally drawn to the most shiny object that moves the most, and that will result in you observing the racket path and the arm and the wrist action for the 1,000th time. And so while your eyes are glued to the racket moving through space, you fail to notice what the foot is doing. And by studying the wrist lag technique again, you fail to see what the hip is doing. And by still sticking your eyes to the racket and looking at the smallest detail in the follow-through, you fail to see a stable foot and perfect balance at the end of the stroke. If you observe a tennis player in match situations, you'll see many different adjustments of technique. All these complex and different movements create less and less clarity on what you should be actually doing if you're trying to solve your own stroke problems. The main mistake here is that you're looking at the player in a match when they're oftentimes stretched to the limit and have to execute a stroke in any way possible to return the ball. As you've seen in the beginning, if you do want to observe technical fundamentals of the pros, you need to look at them in the warm-ups and analyze from the ground up. One of the main reasons why you miss the fundamentals is because you analyze a personal playing style instead of biomechanical fundamentals of the stroke. All these four players have won a Grand Slam, Federer and Nadal of course the most, so obviously they are the best of the best. And yet even just in the initial preparation of the stroke, we can spend hours analyzing all the little details and differences in their wrist positions. And when you focus on little details, you miss the big picture. If you compare contact positions and later follow-throughs, you can again find many differences that add to your confusion of what is the right stroke technique. And to better understand why personal playing styles are not the answer, and why you should actually look for commonalities and not differences in strokes, let me give you one analogy. Looking at different personal playing styles of players is like looking at different car designs. I know Roger is an ambassador for Mercedes-Benz. I remember Andy Murray getting a Jaguar I-Pace for a drive. I think Juan Martín del Potro has a sponsorship with Peugeot, and Nadal has been endorsing Kia Motors for a while, so let's give him a nice Kia Stinger model. So let me get straight to the point. If your forehand is not very effective, and you're trying to improve it by copying a forehand style of a specific player, that's the same as if your car doesn't drive that well, and you think you'll make it much more stable and faster by taking it to a mechanic and changing its shape. The reason why Roger's Mercedes drives so well is not so much related to how it's shaped. It drives well because it has modern technology undercarriage, multi-link suspension, perhaps four-wheel drive, and many other high-tech systems that give it great stability and handling. It also has a modern 6 or 8 valve twin turbo engine that very efficiently and effortlessly produces power with relatively low consumption. But both undercarriage and engine are hidden from our eyes, and yet they are the biggest reasons why driving that Mercedes feels so comfortable and effortless. The shape of the car adds only a little bit to its performance because of its low air drag coefficient. Your goal as a tennis player is to understand what corresponds in your forehand stroke as the undercarriage and the engine, as they are the key to effortless power and comfort. You probably now see the analogy. The car's undercarriage and suspensions function is similar to stability and balance, and the car's engine, where the power is produced, corresponds to the uncoiling and body rotation into the shot. So in my view, the biomechanical fundamentals are a priority when we start correcting a player's technique. We need to start with stability, then make sure the large body segments in the body function correctly during the stroke. And only then can we address the flaws in the swing and start tinkering with the leg techniques and so on. Stay tuned for the next series of videos where I will address each fundamental separately and explain more about it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.